Well, welcome home, church. Thank you. It is good to be home with you all. You know, our God is good, and He has brought us together to worship and to focus in on Him. And, you know, as we continue on in this Lenten season, what we're doing is we're taking a look at the cross, and we're seeing it up ahead, and it's in the distance. And because we can see the cross in the distance and Good Friday in the distance, we can take a look at ourselves and we can say, you know what? I'm not where I need to be. Like, I'm not as good as I could be. I'm not as put together as I should be. And we know that because of the cross, God brings about forgiveness and grace, and that's a good thing. But tonight we get an opportunity to acknowledge two things. One, that we're broken in need of a loving Savior. And two, that loving Savior is working in our brokenness. And so we have an opportunity to worship Him tonight and go before our King. So that's what we're going to do. Amen? So I would invite you to stand. We begin today in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Almighty God, be in this place. Fill our hearts and our lives with your worship. Do not allow us to leave here unchanged, but use this time to mold us and to shape us into who you long for us to be. In your mighty and precious name we pray. Amen. Let's worship.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me in His love for me. Oh, His love for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, it's free.
out to you with a thousand tongues to lift one cry. And from north to south and east to west, we hear Christ be magnified. His name would burst from sea and sky, from rivers to the mountaintops, we hear Christ be magnified. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise.
Thank you.
Well, you all can have a seat. You might notice that things are a little different in here this evening, and we're going to try and help Lenten services look a little bit differently this year. We're going to have a different format, a different way of doing things, but one of the things we started last year that is so special is this opportunity for us to pray as families and as groups. So I would encourage you, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer in just a minute here, but I would encourage you to find a group of people. If you're not with a group of people, I would encourage you to find a group of people and just start praying together. You could use these prompts like, Jesus, you are, or Jesus, help me with, Jesus, I'm sorry for, Jesus, thank you for, Jesus, I'm worried about. And maybe the prayer that you have isn't listed on the prompts. That's okay. We're just giving you an opportunity or an option of what you could pray. But I would just encourage you. I'll open us in prayer, and then you guys go and pray, and then in a few moments, I'll come back up and close us in prayer. Does that sound like a good plan? Okay. All right. So Jesus, thank you for who you are. You are the Lord and giver of life. Jesus, I thank you for these people here, that we are all able to be a family. Jesus, I pray that you would continue to mold this family and shape us. God, continue to turn our hearts towards the people of this community. Help us to show your love and your grace. Jesus, in these times, I pray that you'd give us boldness to pray alongside of one another. We pray all of these things in your mighty and precious name. I thank you for the opportunity that we have to pray as families, as one family. We lift up this time to you, knowing that you are good. We pray all of this in your holy and precious name. Amen. Amen. So again, this time is a little bit different. So here's how this is all going to play out. I'm going to read some scripture. I'm going to do a very short message. Someone say amen. It could be like, Kristen, you sound a little too excited. And then we're going to invite Lindsay Hammer up, and she's going to share her testimony. And we'll pray over her, and then we'll have some questions that we can talk through. And then we'll continue worshiping through all of that. Is that okay? Okay, so Philippians 2, that's where we're going tonight. I would encourage you. We've got pew Bibles in front of you. We've got words on the screen. You could use those too, but it's always nice to be able to look in the Bible. You could pull out your phone and look at scripture through that too. But we're in Philippians chapter 2. And this is what Paul writes to you and to me. He says, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Do all things without grumbling or questioning, that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God, without blemish in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. Hold fast to the word of life, so that in the day of Christ I may be proud that I did not run in vain or labor in vain. Even if I am to be poured out as a drink offering upon the sacrificial offering of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with you all. Likewise, you should also be glad and rejoice with me. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. You know, we've been kind of trying to piece this whole series together. We started on Sunday talking about beholding and how our hope is only in Jesus, and it's only in beholding him and looking at him that we can find the answers and the salvation that we need. And Pastor Mark talked about how we are called and to behold him as the Lamb, the one who takes away the sin of the world. And so as we were thinking through what this Wednesday might look like, we started to talk about this concept of grace in the growing. That as we behold the Lamb of God, we have to recognize that we need the grace that that Lamb offers. And this concept of grace and the growing, I have to be honest with you, I'm still struggling through this. In fact, I wrote a sermon this morning and I crumbled it up. Well, I wrote a sermon and then I crumbled it up this morning and had to rewrite it about 30 minutes before the first service. And I don't know that I've internalized it quite yet. I don't know. I know that God gives grace in the growing. But I think I'm still trying to work through knowing that God gives grace in the growing. You know what I'm saying? Like, it is so easy to know that God gives grace, but so difficult to know that he is giving it for me. And as I think about growing, you know, growing is not a fun thing. It's a good thing, but it's a fun thing. And I think about the painful consequences of growth. You know, I'm turning the big 3-0 this year. And the thing that you all told me would happen that I didn't believe would happen is happening. And I'm waking up sore and I don't know why. And you know what, Brad? That's exactly what Chuck Schutte said earlier. He said, it gets worse. I'm like, that doesn't help. But I think about that, and you know, kids even go through growth spurts and growing pains, and we know that the growing is good, but it doesn't take away the fact that it's still painful. And I think about the emotional and the relational growth pains that we go through. You know, as you move from elementary school to middle school to high school to college, you gain relationships and you lose relationships. And as you go into new periods of life, as you go to a new place of work, or as you move to a new city, those relationships that you hold on to can become distant. And that process of grief is painful. And while it's good, it is painful. And the fact is that this growing process is messy and it hurts. And I think, too, not just about the physical pain of growth or the emotional pain of growth, but the spiritual pain of growth too. We know that as God stretches us, it's not always a fun process. There's this book by Larry Crabb called Shattered Dreams. And the concept is that our ultimate dream as human beings is to be in full relationship with God. But as sinful human beings, you and I put up other dreams that we can attain more easily. Dreams like being a good student, being a good dad, being a good husband, being popular. I don't know what those dreams are, but we set them up. And we use those as the things that we wish to attain. And there are times that God breaks those dreams down. He shatters them for the sake of you and I recognizing the ultimate dream that we have. And I don't know where you are in the process of growing. Maybe you are seeing a dream of yours be shattered right now. Maybe the diagnosis has come back in a way that you don't want it to. Maybe everything seems to be falling down around you, or maybe the success that you hoped for, you got, but it just feels empty. I don't know where you are in the growing process, but what I do know is this, that God works in the midst of the growing. This passage in Philippians I'm tied to, this concept that Paul speaks of. He says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. And oftentimes I stop right there. He calls us to work out our fear, our work out of salvation with fear and trembling. He calls us to not to determine that we are saved or to earn our own salvation, but he calls us to grow, to take that salvation that was given to us by grace alone, through faith alone, and grow that, to deepen our knowledge and to deepen our trust and to deepen our faith. And oftentimes that growing is done with fear and trembling, and I get so caught up in just sticking to that. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. But Paul doesn't stop there. He writes on. He says, for it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. See, in the growing, God is the one who is working. In the pain and the messiness, God brings grace. I don't know who needs to hear that today, but if you are struggling through pain, or if you're struggling through messiness, or if you're struggling through growing, know that God is providing grace to you. He's bringing forgiveness and hope and love. He doesn't look at you and I and say, well, they messed up for the 7,000th time. I'm just done. But he offers us grace upon grace upon grace. And not only does he offer us grace, but he's actively doing something in that. He's actively in the mess. We like to associate God with unmessiness. That's why we like to have the church all nice and tidy. That's why we like our lives to be clean and pure. But God doesn't just work in the clean and pure. He works in the messiness of life too. And so if you are going through the messiness of growing, church, I want you to know that God is working in you. And he's bringing grace. Well, I'm going to invite Lindsay. you His unending peace. May you know that our Savior gives you grace in the midst of the mess, in the midst of the growing. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, thanks for worshiping with us today. We will see you this weekend. Go in peace and serve the Lord.